Hi, I'm Dr. Johnny. Thanks for joining me today. I'm talking Sculptra along the jawline, why it's used, when it's used, what are some of the methods, and why would you use a biostimulator along the jawline as opposed to a filler? Understand the majority of practices don't really use biostimulators. They may advertise it, they may say they do it, but they're using low volumes of Sculptra because fillers make people happy, they're instant, they have a high G prime and they can contour, and you can see it when you go home. You know what you've paid for. It's like, boom, there's the jawline. Or isn't, and when it's not, they're not happy, or if it's irregular, or commonly not enough product. PLLA or Sculptra is a biostimulator. Other ones that you might know of would be, say, Radies, calcium hydroxylapatite, Belafil, PMMA, polymethyl methacrylate, which has been used for many years. They stimulate your own body to produce collagen. So they also have filling components with them, such as Belafil has collagen as a carrier, Radies, of course, carboxymethyl cellulose. In the case of Sculptra, very unique in that it's a water. So people don't think of making jawlines of it, but today I'm gonna show you injections. We're gonna go through some of the do's and don'ts and just talk generally about why possibly would we use a biostimulator versus a filler to get your beautiful jawline. We'll dive right into it, 3 seconds. So Sculptra, like I mentioned, it's diluted in a water, comes as a powder, if you will, and we mix it up. Now, the minute you tell someone we're gonna mix it up and we're gonna dilute it, we're gonna add something, they get scared. They think ripped off because we're diluting it. One of the most common things I get asked everywhere, including trainings, of course, and why it takes a little longer to train on Sculptra, a few things. One is, of course, it's quite particular. You wanna inject it like a helicopter pilot, the same checks and balances every flight, every time. A lot of people have trouble with that structure. And then, of course, the concentrations and dilutions. If you use it a lot, you're not gonna use the same concentration on a jawline as you might in the temple, as you might in the cheek. And then, of course, we're looking at skin because one of the things it does, it's like fertilizer for the face, it tightens skin. So the first dose is like a skin tightener, the next one volumizes. And that's part of what's alluding to why we're gonna use it. And I'm gonna show you exactly how we do the injections. Remember, if you're liking these videos, click like, really helps the algorithm. I like bringing these to you and also knowing what you wanna see because we add polls and I ask, what do you wanna see this week? And I love doing that because it helps me bring to you what you want. And I educate myself before doing the videos and preparing it, so it helps me stay educated on top of my game as well. Also, subscribe, because if you subscribe, you'll be notified of the new videos. And a lot of times, especially people I've trained, will send me and ask questions. What about the cat eye or lifting the cat eye? Do you have something on that? And if you're subscribed, you will have seen each video and have playlists. So for instance, a lot of people want to know PDO threads. Someone asked me recently, hey, they build collagen. How do smooth threads build collagen? I can just almost send people videos on anything they're asking. If you go to the playlist, there's a whole one on the neck, PDO threads, cheek filler. So you can click on those and you can watch them and roll through those if there's a specific topic you're interested in. And of course, just smash the like button at the end when you're seeing, and I want to know your comments as well. So to think about this water, understand we put water in. The whole vial will only take about 10 ml, so 9 ml is what fits in. There are other ways to go to 18:1, sometimes even 36:1 dilutions. One of the things on the jawline is, especially females know this because bone loss is something talked about at the doctor's visits, and they know they have to pay attention to bone, but the bone loses support and structure, you lose bone itself, okay, and calcium, something women know they have to take. And when you get DEXA scans for the wrist or the hip looking for bone loss, we know that it's important because you're losing in other areas, you're definitely losing bone on the face. And I did a video on looking old. So if you want to know all about bones and how they rotate, why it's so important in the face, watch that video because I go through it there. But suffice it to say, the older we get, for all of us, particularly females, will lose bone. That gonial angle can be gone, just gone. When you lose volume here, what happens? It comes down to the front. What does everyone complain of, whether they're in their 20s and come in or beyond 50, 60, 70? It's this. Some people call it the pre-jowl down here, the oral commissure, the RBF. I have videos on those and how to treat them. But the jawline's also important because it helps, when you volumize here, it helps lift everything back, tighten the front. And remember, as we age, we square. Okay for a male sometimes to be a little more square, unless you want the Texas jawline, you might not want to be fully square as a female. Clenching, biting down, grinding teeth, it makes the masseters big, and that's why in Asia particularly, they have great skin. They take care of the masseter with neuromodulators, which people do here, but if the skin is skin type 1, 2, 3, a little bit of 4, but 1, 2, 3, and you get lax, in other words, lighter skin, you get laxity. When you lose the volume that nice masseter is doing, you get the downturn to the mouth. So it's one of those things, there's a very fine balance. You don't want too wide of a jaw, but also you don't want no volume. So what you're gonna see me do with fillers and with sculptors often address the preauricular. Okay, and Sculptra comes as a water. You can see this little device is vortexer. This is how I mix it before putting it into a face because it helps get it nice and uniform, and we don't want the carboxymethyl cellulose in the syringe because that's what's clogging. The only other things in the syringe, of course, we put the water, there's the PLLA, and there's mannitol used in the freeze drying or the drying process, the preparation of that powder. And so those are the only things, the carboxymethyl cellulose, there's a way to mix that up to get rid of that. We teach that all in the trainings, and most people do, a lot of sculptors know it. Why? Because clogging Sculptra drives people crazy. And I wanna say it's a number one reason that people fail with Sculptra, but probably there's other reasons, but the number one that they get frustrated and they say, I'm not doing this. It's surprisingly, it's clogging. And when you go in and you do it like that helicopter pilot method where everything's the same, checks and balances, sometimes you'll go a day without one clog. When you get them, there's ways to get rid of them. So why are we picking a liquid over a G prime filler? And I have this question here. So what's G prime? G prime is a way to measure, not an exact science, but it's a way to measure. Think of the stiffness of a product. It's more complex than that. If you think of a bungee ball, or what would you call it, like a Pilates ball, where you push it down and it bounces back in the shape of a ball, no matter what, unless you blow it up, of course. That's what a filler does. It wants to keep its shape, maintain its shape. That's strength. What's the highest G prime filler we have? Of course, calcium. Calcium hydroxylapatite or Radies. 70% of that's gonna be carboxymethyl cellulose and carrier, and 30% is gonna be your calcium biostimulator. So it's a great choice for the jawline as well, especially if you want that Vegas weekend. I'm going to Vegas this weekend, I want a sharp jawline. You get out your Radies, boom, you got a jawline. It does stimulate collagen. 70% of the carrier, of course, goes away. With Sculptra, what we're gonna show you today, it's a biostimulator and PLLA. Remember I said the first dose is a skin tightener, the next one's a volumizer? So we're using the volumizing secondary, the first dose is gonna be skin tightening. So if the water was gone after 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days, the bead's tiny, 50 microns, it builds up slowly. So if they were in Vegas for a week, which no one wants to be in Vegas for a week, you can't take, I've been there for a week, it's not a good thing for you. Then the water could be gone, and by day 6, 7, they're unhappy. The Radies will maintain. Okay, the carboxymethyl cellulose, yes, at 3 months will be gone, but the calcium will maintain longer, a year plus, and then stimulate collagen. The collagen you get from these, type 1 and 3 collagen, type 2 isn't applicable to the skins found elsewhere, like bone cartilage. That's the collagen, that's why we always talk about the collagen you keep is yours to keep. Meaning, how long do things last? When they build collagen, that collagen can last you as long as you are good to it. Typically, it's breaking down naturally and reproducing over the course of 1 to 2 to 3 years, but it will accelerate with smoking, poor lifestyle, poor metabolism. Not necessarily hypermetabolism. People, I'm a runner, I burn it off. They're getting rid of bone, maybe, yes. Diet plays a role, but also their fat pads, probably more important than the loss of collagen from activity and exercise, which helps your machinery. Food, diet, exercise, avoiding sun, solar issues. So let's watch the Sculptra being done along the jawline. I'm gonna show you one method. There's many methods to do it, and this is something, concentrations are important, depths are important, anatomy is important. I'm gonna show it to you now, but it's something, you don't just pick up Sculptra and do it unless you're trained on it, particularly on the jawline. You want to be trained in using it because typically it's high concentration, high dose. We're on the bone, mimicking bone. Let's go to the video and I'll narrate you through that. So one of the most important things we're doing is cleaning. We have to cleanse. Purisin is really good to use. The key is anything else that's in there, you can introduce bacteria. You want to know where the masseter is because in front of it is the facial artery and you want to stay away from that. Here I'm using a cannula. I rarely use cannulas with Sculptra because I'm on the periosteal level, but for this region, I can get there nicely with a cannula. I'm going to be around the facial artery. There's risks to every single procedure. If you don't want risk, don't get anything done. These are treatments are optional, and when you're getting something done, understand you're gonna assume risks. So you keep it clean. That pad I use is doused with Purisin, and that helps keep everything nice and clean. I'm using I use 22 gauge cannulas mainly, especially in jawlines. When you're getting fillers or hyaluronic acid fillers, doing 5 vials around the jawline, pretty normal. Because think of the 1 ml is almost nothing. 5 ml is a teaspoon. Here I'm advancing. I'm extremely careful in the region of the in front of the masseter because that facial artery is there and you want to avoid it. This is a very large gauge cannula, so typically it's going to bounce off of that vessel, but I'm aware of where it is and I'm cautious around that. It starts on the bone and becomes superficial as it moves up towards the mouth. Here I want to get, I don't want to inject at the pre-gel, but I do want to inject anterior to the pre-gel and posterior to it. Understand there will be some swelling with this technique in the jowl itself. People have to understand, cannula is large and it's blunt. Now I finish these injections off by injecting the gonial angle. So I'm coming right in at the gonial angle. I'm bolusing high dose on the periosteum. I use a large gauge needle here, pulling back, make sure I'm not in a vessel. Sometimes you are going through muscle, of course, the masseter, but I like to go inferior and just avoid most of it. And then one of the most important things here is we're not massaging a lot after here. My massage routine down here is less because I want it to sit where it is and produce that beautiful collagen and mimic that bone. Now that technique, I'm not telling you to go out and do that technique. I'm showing you something. I've done several hundred of these now. I'm not in the thousands to tell you more than the data I have on it because of the dosing I'm using is high dose. Understand, nodules with Sculptra that everyone fears is typically around concentric muscles and high dose like this. Understand too that before it was approved aesthetically, Sculptra caused some nodules. It was used in different concentrations and doses from now. However, if there was a small nodule here, if someone felt it, just like maybe fillers, not a bad thing because this is peripheral. You don't see it, you feel it. It's creating volume. Understand that about products. Nodules are not always a bad thing. We never want them. And definitely want to avoid them around the eyes and the mouth and areas where you might see them or movement areas. Static areas, some parts of the world, they'll inject a lot of product back here just to get pull. So there you go, Sculptra. Let me know, do you like it? What do you like along the jawline? What do you use? What do you want to see in upcoming videos? Click like, subscribe, join me next time. Keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.